He was in Africa at that time, and one day a missionary society wrote a letter to him. And one of the lines of the letter said, I hope, according to the writer, I hope that you have found the right way, and if you have found one, write back to us and we will send some more to follow after you. Livingstone wrote back and he said, I don't want you to send men and women after me who are looking for a road. I want you to send committed men and women who will come after me even if there is no road at all. That is commitment. And you guys, you have to make sure that you have that commitment in your hearts, because to be a medical student is not an easy task. You'll be going through a lot of difficulties, hardships, and all that. I'm very sure that the Lord will guide you, so long as you have that commitment and willingness to follow the Lord, and so long as you will cooperate with a faculty who will guide you and mold you to become the kind of missionary doctors that the Lord wants you to be. Somebody said here, Pastor Asoy, he said that this medical school is late in coming for his children. I can also say that for my children. Our eldest is a medical doctor. Our second to the youngest just graduated from the medical school that Dr. Pastor Asoy was telling you about. And our youngest is taking her medical school practice in Iloilo. She's going to be on her fourth year next year. Too late for my children, but not too late for you. So do the best that you can, because the future is in your hands. And you, students, will write down the history of what's going to happen starting tomorrow. And I'm praying that the history that you'll write about will be a glorious history. A history of students who took the long, difficult road following Christ, becoming medical doctors, missionary doctors who will give healing and wholeness to the people of this world. May God bless you. May God bless the faculty and help. Every one of us should be helping each other. As the chairman of the Board of Trustees, I was asking myself, what can the Board of Trustees do to help the medical school? Well, we don't know the problems. Well, we've been exposed to the many problems that College of Medicine have encountered the past 5 years. We don't know the problems that they'll be meeting in the future, but this one thing I can say, we're going to try to help you the best we can. And with the Lord's leading, we're going to help each other so that especially you, students, will become medical missionary doctors who will bring healing and wholeness to the people around. God bless us all.
Thank you very much, Pastor Manyas. Now, as a felicitation coming from a partner of the AUPCUM, Dr. Ramoncito Magnaye, the Medical Center Chief 2 of the Batangas Medical Center. A big hand to Dr. Magnaye.
Good morning. Earlier this week, there was a threat of typhoon. But look outside, it's a beautiful day. A little rain coming here, but rain is not necessarily bad. It nourishes the land. And rains are like some problems that when they come, they make us stronger. To Dr. Hardy and Dr. Hardy and Dr. Landness, to the parents, to the other guests, to the faculty, colleagues, doctors, and future doctors. Congratulations on the Adventist University of the Philippines College of Medicine on our inauguration and the white coat ceremony. Few years back, actually it was many years back, I was still the training officer. It was just an appointment, no added salary. We were talking with Dr. Doris about the dream of putting up this College of Medicine. And it was just a dream. There were a many series of meetings, consultations, ocular visits, problems, emails, texts, communications, even at night. Texts, calls, even on Sundays. But never on a Saturday. Don't worry, I understand this perfectly. On a side note, I have first cousins who live beside me. I grew up with actually the children of the twin of my father. Some of you may know them, the Dimalibots of Batangas. They are family of doctors, nurses, medtechs. I grew up with them. I went to your church. I went to their school. Some of them are alumni of AUP. And now they are continuing they're everywhere in the world. But what amazes me is not only the art of healing, but their missionary work. So when, aside from Dr. Doris, Dr. Jojo Gulfan, where's Jojo? Joseph and Dr. Bibli Makaya, we were friends, surgeons. We're planning this. Okay, we'll do this. We'll be your base hospital. Because knowing close Adventists, and I see your brochure or your notes and talking to most of you, we share the same mission in Batangas Medical Center. Few years ago when we were starting this, what's called BRH, Batangas Regional Hospital, and we had the same journey. Since then, I was the training officer before I became chief. It was a 150-bed government hospital. Now we're admitting more than 300. We built some new buildings, like your very beautiful building. We're still building some and acquired new equipments. We've added human resource, doctors, nurses, to help in the training so that we could be prepared in training you. We're ISO certified. In a few months, you'll be walking the halls, the rooms, the patients of BATMC, the Batangas Medical Center. And we share I hope we could be part in sharing with you the core values of BATMC, which is easy to remember, ICE, I-C-E. We want you to be cool. ICE stands for integrity, compassion, and excellence. So fast forward to the future. I still see some of my doctors here. Can we please stand up from those who are connected from BATMC? Some people are still coming over, or you will see them. Okay. So, the challenge, thank you. The challenge is really in us, trainers, to mold these young minds, young hearts, dito sa here in medicine, if you love medicine and you treat people, and you do the missionary, merong forever. Kaya we help them mold into the future partnership of AUP and the BATMC that as see these people in front in the future. And I'm sure you will be doctors, but I pray that you will be doctors with 4 C's. In DOH, we're very fond of acronyms. Department of Health in Public Service. I hope you will be doctors, what's the 4 C's? Competence, commitment, compassion, and a little creativity. I'll add the 5th C, clean and green. Again, congratulations. More power to us all. Mabuhay.
Thank you very much, Dr. Magdaye. Representing the ESNAC, an alumni association of our graduate in the States, let us welcome Dr. Sal Corquinez for his felicitation.
Honored guests, members of the faculty, parents, ladies and gentlemen. A dream come true. Speaking of dreams, when I was younger, I really wanted to be a medical doctor. My brother became a doctor. My 2 sisters became nurses. And my father one day said, go to PUC and take theology. My dream didn't come true. So yesterday, when I saw Dr. Mendoza, I said, this will be my chance. I'm going to enroll and become a medical doctor. And you know what she said? You're too old. We have an age limit. I'm already 73 years old, but still I have that dream. All of us have dreams. It is one of the many things that make us uniquely human. I wish I could expound on this, but somebody gave me a note which says 5 minutes. Today, a dream has become a reality. And I'm so proud to see that one of our students of Pacific View Academy is one of the first students of the medical school of Andrews University. Dr. Gayuba, I'm so proud to introduce to you Ms. Kabili. Will you please stand? Yeah. The first graduate of our school in Matnog, Sorsogon, Pacific View Academy. And her parents are here today. Will you please stand? Thank you very much. It is with great joy and happy hearts that the officers and members of the Eastern North America chapter of the Adventist University of the Philippine Alumni wish to celebrate the inauguration of this medical school, a dream come true. Allow me to just read what I'm printed here because the minutes are passing by. Many of us could never have imagined witnessing this in our lifetimes. So many obstacles, so many setbacks, so many hope dashed. But thanks to the leadership of the Adventist University of the Philippines, we are here today to witness this momentous event. ISNAC is committed to help AUP in the furtherance of this dream. We know this is just the beginning as we stand by ready to help in any way that we can. For we believe that the fulfillment of this dream is just another step in the fulfillment of another great hope, the second coming of Christ. Let us celebrate our yesterdays. Let us celebrate today. Let us keep dreaming for a better tomorrow. Congratulations, and may God richly bless you. Mabuhay ang AUP and mabuhay sa lahat.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sal Corquinez, President of ESNAC. For our last felicitation, let us welcome Dr. Elmer Bangloy, the President of AWESNA.
To all present here today, the Adventist University of the Philippines, AWESNA, or the Alumni of Western North America, which expands into the states of California, Oregon, Washington, Nevada, goes to the plains of the provinces of Canada, which includes British Columbia and Alberta, and all of the Hawaiian Islands. I extend to you a heartfelt congratulations for this inaugural opening of the College of Medicine. Without a doubt, this has been an accelerating and exhausting time, filled with plans to pursue and deadlines to meet. The multitude of opportunities that we have and the unforeseen challenges are coming into focus, and your agenda at the start of your historic class is taking shape. This is a once-in-a-lifetime experience, a time that will set the course of the medical college for many years to come. AWESNA wish you success as you move forward to these, or from these heady ceremonial days into the significant work that the College of Medicine will undertake. I pray together with my fellow alumni at AWESNA that God will give you the insight and the fortitude to accomplish that which AUP needs you to do, and give you the courage to continue to dream, because it is those that dare to dream that this college is now a reality. Let us, as Thomas Jefferson said, in education, dream of an aristocracy of achievement is a democracy of opportunity. With this, we will all be a part. With this, AWESNA will be a part esteemed guest, fellow alumni, university leaders, teachers, professors, and supporters, to the founding dean, Dr. Doris Mendoza, and to the pioneering bats, the first bats, let us, as Thomas Jefferson said, in education, dream of an aristocracy of achievement is a democracy of opportunity. I invite you to believe in this, for by the grace of God, there will be great days ahead for the College of Medicine at AUP. Again, congratulations and thank you. God bless us all.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bangloy, for that felicitation. At this point in time, let's listen to the financial report coming from the Vice President for Finance of AUP, Dr. Robert Borromeo.
Good morning, everybody. As I was listening to the inspiring, pleasant words, I wish my part would not be here. So fasten your seat belts. My presentation has two parts. The first one is about how this building was financed, and the second part is the would-be and the operation of this college. All right. All right. How much is the actual cost of the alumni building? It's only 114 million. Total donations received, praise the Lord, 59.9 million. That's about 51% of the cost of the project. And the university committed to provide 10 million. So, you know what's next? How did we finance, all right, this building where we are here now? Okay. Total amount advanced from the coffers of the university, 59.2 million. So, friends, even at this moment, we are still praying hard, hoping that we will get the balance in the near future. And yesterday, those who were here, there was an appeal that we will offer ourselves through offerings, financial offerings. And so let me show to you the response, even in a short notice, of our people. August 8th, cash that was collected, cold cash, amounted to 74,000, and pledges, dollars in dollars, US dollars, and in peso, Philippine peso, 829,550. So total offerings, almost 1 million brethren. So that's the first part. Now let me go to the second part. Again, please fasten your seat belts. We started spending for this dream, which is now a reality, back in 2011. And in that year, 2011, 2012, that's in millions, that's 149,000. We spent in that year 149,000. Succeeding years, all right, so you have almost 1 million. And then the following years, 3.9 million. No student yet, take note. These are all expenses. No revenue yet. Okay. Even at this time, 2014, 2015, 3.8 million. And the total of our startup cost, okay, oh, we still, and including April to June, 2 million. Total, July is not yet included. Total is already almost 11 million pesos. Okay. As you view my presentation, and if you look through the eyes of finance, and even if you apply any tool of capital budgeting, you would say this project may not be viable. But friends, as I said during the Vespers service, during the interview, let us believe that this project must be viewed in the eyes of faith. You cannot find the word faith in any finance book in the world. You can validate that by looking at any library. But we acted out in faith. And so, I know that starting tomorrow, Monday, the Assistant Vice President for Finance, Mrs. Golosino, she's here. All right, would you mind to stand, ma'am? A very dedicated and diligent finance officer. I'm certain that there will be more butterflies in her stomach. Hopefully, they will not. This will not lead to gastro. What is that? Gastro type. Enteritis and adultitis. But brethren, our alumni supporters, just as I said last Friday evening, I want to believe that the Lord works in ways our eyes cannot even see, and much more we cannot even imagine. That the Lord pour out his blessings even when we least expect it. And lastly, that the Lord shall provide. So, I believe that this project will be sustained because the Lord promised so. Mabuhay ang College of Medicine, mabuhay ang AUP. Maraming salamat po.
Thank you, Dr. Bormayo. At this point in time, let us listen to a special song from the AUP Faculty Ensemble, Ivan Perdido conducting.
nostra pace. Lasciarlo seminare l'amore.
Where there is hatred, let me sow love.
Dove ci è ferita, sperare, dove ci è nerezza, illuminarsi, dove ci è la tristezza, gioia.
Thank you very much, AUP Ensemble. For the introduction of the speaker for our quiet coat ceremony, let us welcome Dr. Bibly Makaya, the President of the Adventist Medical Center Manila and the Chair of the Department of Clinical Sciences, AUP College of Medicine. Let us give a big hand to Dr. Makaya.
Good morning. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct honor to introduce to you a dear friend, a world-renowned urologist, educator, and lecturer, which I got to know through a fellow urologist, Dr. Moorhead, early 1990s. I was given the curriculum vitae of 32 pages, and it is my burden to summarize it in 10 minutes. I consider him as my idol. As I scan through the pages of his curriculum vitae, I got to know him better. I tried to analyze and compare myself. And I found out we have 8 similarities. First, we both graduated our medical studies around age 23. Why is that so? I'll tell you later. We both finished general surgery and later be certified. After general surgery, we both went to urology specialty training and we are both certified. By the way, urology is a specialty which deals with the innermost private parts. And our speaker today even go beyond by specializing in female urology. We both love to teach interns and residents until today. We are passionate about playing golf. And we have the same handicap. Who is the better player, Dr. Magnai? It has to be settled. I played in his course and I lost. He played in my course and he lost. So we will play in your course to settle, doctor. We both love to do selfie photos. But yesterday he taught me the basic of photojournalism. And later in his speech, you will know why. Number 7, we are both overstaying administrator. He is the dean for the past 13 years. Number 8, he has a Filipino heart. His son, Craig, is married to a Filipina, Miss Tangonan, and he has a granddaughter with a Filipino blood. I wish to thank him publicly, for he is the one who nominated me to be a member of American Urology Association in 1999. Also, he accepted my invitation to be our speaker at Manila Adventist College in 2012. Yesterday, Dan Mendoza talked about the purpose of the College of Medicine. And AUP aims to educate medical doctors of as 5-star physician plus medical missionary. My advice to our inaugural buds, first, you have to emulate Jesus Christ. Secondly, as a living example, you may emulate our speaker today as a 5-star physician. First, clinician. In 1974, he graduated in Loma Linda College of Medicine on accelerated program, 5 years. He both received his BS and medical degrees in 1974. He finished general surgery program, 5 years, and then he finished a urology program of 3 years, and then went to a 1-year fellowship training at University of California, Los Angeles, under a renowned professor in female urology and urodynamics. His urology journey brought him to world, Saigon, Vietnam, Switzerland, Greece, in other parts of the world. He has 4-generation urologists in his family. His grandfather, his father, himself, and his son. Yet, he has another brother, also a urologist. And he has a famous grandfather by the name of Roger Barnes. I used to study medicine, and I found out early that Roger Barnes is the pioneer in TURP. You know what's TURP? Transurethral resection of the prostate. Second, you may emulate him as a teacher. He is a passionate teacher of surgery and urology. He teaches the clerks, residents, and fellow consultants. He is a full-time professor at 40 years. Very rare you could achieve that. He is a head of urology for 13 years in Loma Linda, from 1990 to 2003. He is a visiting professor and lecturer in national USA and abroad. He is a world-renowned authority in female urology, urodynamics, and incontinence. He is a researcher. He is a prolific one. He won many research contests and authored more than 70 journals published. And then he is also an author of more than 20 chapters in the urology, which is also our text Bible, which is Campbell Urology. He is a social mobilizer. He's a resource person in radio and television programs. At the same time, he is also a deacon and a head elder of his local church. Administrator, number five, he has been the dean of the College of Medicine since 2003 of Loma Linda University, executive vice president, Medical Affairs, Loma Linda, since 2003. He is the chief of staff, Loma Linda, since 2003, and this year, chief medical officer of Loma Linda University Health. In his leadership, he enhanced the DOM. What is DOM? It's not what you think. It's a deferred overseas mission program. They develop also a scholarship program for students, for academic, which wish to stay as teacher of Loma Linda University in basic sciences. So from that time on until now, he was able to increase the faculty to a present 40% basic and clinical professors. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct honor to you to introduce a dear friend, clinical expert surgeon, world-renowned urologist, researcher, author, radio TV guest, veteran administrator, loving father, grandfather of a Filipina-American, photojournalist, and selfie expert. Please welcome the multi-talented, fiercely dedicated, and humble, yet passionate servant of the Lord, the Dean of Loma Linda College of Medicine, Dean Roger Hadley.
Thank you, and it certainly is a privilege to be here. Are we missing somebody? A couple empty chairs? Maybe they got that urological thing going? You know, all those years of education, I'm down to two questions. You know, the more training you take, actually, the less you know. It's down to two questions. Can you hold or can you go? And that's all I have to ask my patients. I consider this a true honor to be here. I wish I could have been at Loma Linda in 1909. They started the medical school. But I've had a chance to look at the history of Loma Linda and learn about how it started, and you've got a lot better head start than we did. You've got a lot of things in order. Great faculty. Right now I'm looking at 10 times the faculty Loma Linda had when it started. Respect them. I respect your teacher. And I'm going to look at the faculty and I'm going to tell them something my dad taught me a long time ago. He says, treat the students well. Because a few years from now, they will be your doctor. I have operated on an even in academy, in high school, our class sponsors, I've been their surgeon on both of our class sponsors. And I've had two surgeries myself, both done by former students. So we'll treat you well. We depend on you. Dr. Bibley mentioned that I'm one of four generations of urologists. And there's a picture of all four of us. The two little children that are on the couch looking up at their great-grandfather are now 35 years of age. One is a urologist, that's my son. The other, for reasons that, you know, the genes aren't always 100%. He's an orthopedist. But it's fun to be part of a family, to be able to talk urology. My wife thinks there's too much spoken at our house. But it's pretty simple. This is your first lesson, by the way. There's the kidney. There's two tubes that connect the kidneys to the bladder. They're called the ureter, not the urethra. They look alike. They sound alike. But it's the ureter. And if you're from England, it's called the ureter. North America, it's ureter. What is it here? Ureter? Ureter, not ureter. The other great thing about becoming a urologist, you can have neat license plates like "It Flows." You know, I arrived yesterday morning at 4 a.m, and I'll tell you one thing I'm impressed. Talk about servant leadership. Is meeting me at the airport at 4 a.m. was your dean, and thank you very much for meeting at the airport. I had met her a number of years ago in 2007 when she came by my office. And she was there to get some care, and she came by the office, truly someone committed to education. Now, since I've been here, I've been reacquainted for the first time in a long time with Dr. Garcia. The minute he introduced himself to me, it suddenly all the memories came back. And you will have these real soon. He doesn't remember it. I don't expect him to. Because as a physician, you'll have learning moments, hopefully every day. But the ones you learn early are the ones you learn the most, the one you remember the longest. I was only in my second month of medical school. I was on the clinical services second month. And my intern was Dr. Garcia. And I learned something from him. He did a procedure on a patient in such a way that he insufflated air through a tube. And we knew if the other bottle had air coming through it, there's a connection that meant a very poor prognosis for the patient. And he quietly standing there while the patient was awake, I can remember standing next to him as he insufflated, and sure enough, unfortunate for the patient, the bubbles came out the other side. I watched him. What's he going to say to the patient? He looked up at the chief resident, and he kind of gasped, because now everything was going to be different for the patient. He whispered in soft, respected tones. And the respect he then gave the patient after that is tattooed in my brain. Learn from your elders, the intern, the resident, the teacher. They have always something to teach you. Also, become a teacher. You've gotten a lot of challenges. I'd like to challenge you to become a teacher. We need them. And here's Dr. and Mrs. Lau. Dr. and Dr. Lau, he's one of our teachers at Loma Linda. He's our faculty, and he's here today. Family is important. Yesterday I saw Ruby Tangunen. I say Tangunen, but I think it's Tan Unen. Is that right? Tan Unen? And she reminded me, I'd seen her 2 or 3 years ago here, and she reminded me, she's a cousin once removed, of Kimmy Tan Unen. I show this wedding picture, mainly because of Kimmy, but something also relatively important. And the person next to her is Craig, and Craig is my son. So I have a Filipina daughter-in-law, and that's very important to me. Also very important is that they have a grandchild, and that grandchild is Maya. And as anyone here who has grandchildren, these things are the most precious things on this earth. You don't understand that. You will understand that. You mentioned I'm an expert. I'm not. But the year 2013 was the Oxford Dictionary's word of the year was selfie. The new word is called selfie. You know what a selfie is that correct? Well, I demonstrated to your parents the selfie technique. And then this is called a selfie in a selfie. And this one here, I think you can see it, is a selfie in a selfie with a photobomb. Can you see the guy back here? That's a photobomb. If you ever wonder what a radiologist selfie looks like, this is what a radiologist selfie looks like. Just don't do it too often. Well, I come from California, where there's snow on the mountains, just clear air now. But I want to point to something. Can you see my pointer? It's over here. Right at the top of this hill, it was about 1905, and we just last year made a bronze statue of Ellen White in a horse-drawn trailer, wagon, horse-drawn wagon, with her son Willie next to her, talking to the man standing, John Burden, and you've heard the story. But she turned to her son and she said, "Willie, I've been here before." "No, mother, you have not been." "I believe I've been here before." "Mother, you have not been here before." She said, "Well, then, this is the very place that God has shown me for an institution to deliver health care and to educate the next generation of health care providers will be." And thus, Loma Linda was born. She wrote about it. She said the medical school at Loma Linda, and I put in parentheses AUP, because it applies exactly to you, is to be of the highest order, because those who are in that school have the privilege of maintaining a living connection with the wisest of all physicians, Jesus Christ, from which there is communicated knowledge of a superior order. And Loma Linda's purpose then and is the same purpose as it is today, and that is to train excellent clinicians, teach whole person care. You've heard that word a number of times, which means you're going to manage the patients, not only their physical and mental health, but you're going to also manage their spiritual needs. You'll fill a gap that other medical schools in North America, and this is for Loma Linda, leave empty. 145 medical schools in the United States. Only five are faith-based, and we're the only one that has an overt message that will address the patient's spiritual needs. And our third goal is to provide extraordinary opportunities for missionary medical service. Now, if I just change that and put AUP, the purpose is the same. The only word I changed is Asia in place of North America. Our first class started in 1909, your first class, 2015. It was by 2011 we'd graduate our 10,000th graduate. I put a question mark. Will 2111 be when you graduate your 10,000th graduate? You don't think it's possible, do you? But remember, who only knows when the second coming? Only God knows. We have over 1,000. I hope you can double that who serve missionary service. So this is about you. This is about today. This is about the white coat and what it means. The first white coat ceremony. And I predicted about when I would be speaking, and I was close enough. But it was 49 hours ago that we had our white coat ceremony at Loma Linda. And the next is a video of the year before, the excitement they experienced on the first day of school for this incoming freshman class. With the same hope and dreams that you have, it is international. You all act alike. You all have the same aspirations, and it's all focused on service and the Lord. So there's the white coat. It's got a number of meanings. I'm going to speak to you what it means to the patient and what it means to the doctor. First of all, for the patient, when they see you walk in with a white coat, it should, and it does, represent that they can trust you. It comes with the white coat is trust. It also indicates that you are competent, capable person, that you have empathy for their problem, and that you're there to provide hope. Let me then say the doctor, how he sees or she sees the white coat is that it's a privilege and honor to serve and that you have gratitude. Trust. This is what the patient sees of you when you walk in with a white coat. They trust that you will take ownership to their problem, that their needs will supersede your needs, and that you remain diligent in providing for your patient. And what I mean by taking ownership, and what I mean by remaining diligent, is best illustrated by a non-medical story, but it happened to me, and it happened in Manila in April of 2012. I arrived at the airport to head home. They had an initial screening machine. This wasn't the one you have to go through to get on the airport, on the airplane, but it was just to get in the airport. Well, I did the routine things by put my bag on, took everything metal out of my pocket, and I took my phone and I took my camera and put in a little container and let it go through the screen. Well, guess what? I picked up everything except my phone and my camera. I went in, checked in my luggage, and was walking. It took about 30 minutes to check in my luggage. Started walking towards the terminal, and a uniformed officer came up to me and said, "Sir, I believe these are yours." I couldn't believe it. Up to that moment, I didn't know they were missing. Do you know how he figured it out? This is taking ownership to a problem. The first thing he did, he took the camera. He knows how to shoot pictures. He knows how to review pictures. So he started thumbing through, and he figured someone in that picture owns this camera. And he saw one that looked logical, and he kept looking for me, kept looking for me, kept looking for me. He then took my phone. He looked at my last call. He says, "I think I know where that is." But when he saw me, he says, "I think that's him." And when he gave me the camera and the phone back, he said, "By the way, you're a Seventh-day Adventist, aren't you?" "Yeah, I am." He says, "I can tell. You visited AUP." He could recognize the AUPs. That's taking ownership to the problem. That's what makes a good student. That's what makes a good intern. That's what makes a good resident. That's what makes you a competent, caring, trustworthy doctor. You need to be available when your patient needs you, and trust is something that you have to earn every day. One action on your part can take the trust away forever of that one patient. A lack of confidence, lack of paying attention. Competence is the second component of the white coat. You need from this day on be a lifelong learner. We say the word practice of medicine because that's what it is. You get better every day. You work each day to become a better doctor today than you were yesterday. And every doctor will tell you this. Every patient has something to teach you. Listen. Listen carefully. Empathy is part of the coat, the white coat. Let your personal pain, emotional, physical, or spiritual, become your best teacher and motivator. If you lose a best friend, if you're stricken with an illness, if your father and mother seem to pass away sooner than they should have, don't allow that to affect you negatively. Use it as to understand your patients better. Because the more you can feel their pain, the more they will they'll benefit from you as being a doctor. Then finally, hope. The white coat. When you walk into the room, you provide hope that you will alleviate them from their pain and a hope for cure. They also hope that they'll never be left alone and that this life on this earth is not the end of their story. So now most doctors are trained for cure. They're trained to alleviate pain, but it's the doctors from AUP which will be there to provide them hope. It's an added value of yours that they will not be left alone. Just 23rd Psalms is a perfect example of that. Give them some spiritual guidance. The shadows of death, I'll fear no evil because, God, you're with me. I'm not alone. And that hope that this life is not the end of their story. The promise, the most quoted, most often quoted promise of John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. This is what you have to offer the patient. Not only a cure and alleviation for pain and suffering, but they won't be left alone, and that this life is not the end of their story. This is what defines you and what the AUP white coat means. And that pathway to hope is prayer. Most people are well acquainted with prayer. Most people have their children dedicated soon after birth. Most teach their children to say their blessing. Most people teach their children to say their prayers at night. And at weddings and at funerals, prayer is given. Patients move to prayer. Patients move to their spiritual side when there's important moments of their life. And getting a negative diagnosis or diagnosed with a poor prognosis is a very important part of their life. Look and become an expert. Watch your mentors. Look for opportunities to learn when the best way for a patient to be introduced to prayer and when to pray. Now for the doctor, it's a privilege to wear a coat. It's an honor to serve others. There are more than 2,000 texts in the Bible that tells us to serve those in need. And this is our purpose. At Loma Linda, at the center of the campus, is the story of the Good Samaritan, which is about service to others. It's a compelling story which reminds every student every day about what our purpose is. I was inspired by Dr. David, who spoke about his continued and passionate purpose of reaching out to others. And then gratitude. Never, ever take for granted that you have this privilege. Be grateful and accept patients' gratitudes for what you've done for them. Just recently, I was forced to recall a story that happened on July 4 of 1985, or 30 years ago. It's a good story. The patient had to remind me, because I'd forgotten. She said that you came in on July 4, which in the United States is a holiday. It's the Independence Day. It's our National Freedom Day. An available kidney became available for this patient, and we were able to transplant her. It's a relatively routine transplant. I lost complete track of her and kind of forgotten about her. And then just about 6 weeks ago, I got a phone call to come back to the Transplant Institute that they were celebrating 30 years of a successful transplant. I went over there and I met Karen Gwaltney, who 30 years before, I put a kidney in her, and it's lasted 30 years. It's a long time for a kidney to last, a transplant. She had gratitude, and I was grateful that they called me. Then another story about gratitude, which sort of beat all odds. I was a student missionary, Saigon, Vietnam, in 1974. In Saigon, I was accompanied the heart team, which had gone to a number of countries and done the first open heart surgery on children with congenital heart disease. There was one particular patient, about 14 years of age, that we operated on, repaired a hole in her heart called a ventricular septal defect. And she recovered without incident. We left Vietnam, didn't think about her since. Then 5 years ago, I got an email. The email said, "Sir, my mother, 35 years ago, in Saigon, Vietnam, had open heart surgery, and she was operated on by a group of American doctors. She was in prison several times, caught trying to escape Vietnam, finally made it to Canada, but she lost all track of her records and who the doctors were that saved her life. She cuts hair every day, and she asks every one of her clients, 'Do you have any idea who the people could have been?' One client searched on the internet and says, 'Why don't you try Loma Linda?' So, doctor, I'm now trying Loma Linda. Is there any chance that your team had come over and operate on her?" And I'm reading this email. I got it in the dean's office, and I couldn't believe it. Well, I keep all my pictures in my computer, and I had this picture of all the patients we're operated on. And I said, are you in this picture? So I sent this picture back 35 years later. She said, "Yes. I'm the woman standing holding the IV bag. On the left-hand side, I have found my doctors." She said, "Could you please come up here? I would like to cut your hair for free." I never pass up an opportunity, so I boarded a flight from California to British Columbia. And there I met Wynne and her husband. And yes, she cut my hair. One last story. I was in Sicily about 6-7 years ago. I wanted to get on the internet, so I looked up a street, and I saw an internet cafe up a long walkway, so I went up there. And I'm telling this story because once you put on the white coat and you see a patient, they in their own mind have an idea of who you are. And whether they see you in the marketplace or the mall or on the park, they'll recognize you as their doctor, and they'll watch you, and they'll see what kind of person you are. Once you've taken the profession of medicine and a lot of other careers, teachers, ministry, etc., people watch you to see who you are in real life. You cannot be good just when you have the white coat on. You've got to be good. You've got to be behaving all the time. So I step in that internet cafe far away from home in Sicily. And I sat down, and the person turned to me and says, "Hi, Dr. Hadley." And I go, "Oh, man, can't hide from anybody." And it was Dr. Wallen. He was a radiology resident. But it reminded me of a little film clip my father took of me when I was 5 years old. I'm having a snit. I've got a bad temper. I'm complaining about something. I'm not certain, but my dad had the presence to take a picture. And I hope it projects well, but you'll notice that whenever I see the camera and realize I'm on camera, suddenly my behavior changes. So there I am at age 5. Get the camera comes on, then the camera goes off, whining and screaming. Oh, what do I hear? The camera. Yeah, my best behavior. It wasn't just 2 times, it was 3 times. I hear that camera again. Yep. Okay. So, remember, the white coat resembles trust. You need to earn it every day. It means competence. Learn from your patients. Empathy. Learn about yourself and how that can make you a better doctor. And hope. This will define you as an AUP doctor. Prayer. Pray without ceasing. It is the pathway to hope. And you are fulfilling God's command to serve. That's what the Bible says. It's what you need to do. And never, never not be grateful for what you have. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Roger Hadley, for that inspirational message. At this point in time, let us have Dr. Doris Mendoza for the response and the introduction of the College of Medicine of AUP faculty.
Good morning. Thank you for coming and bearing with us. It's almost lunchtime. If you would excuse the students now, they just went up to prepare for the white coat ceremony. Thank you so much, Dean Roger Hadley, my big brother, and I would say my very tall brother, counterpart from Loma Linda University School of Medicine, our role model of Adventist medical education. Truly, your illustrious record is a hard act to follow. But God's grace is sufficient to see us through. Amen? Amen. This weekend is a Thanksgiving celebration of the fulfillment of the many, many decades-long dream of the AUP community and the Adventist Global Family to establish a center for medical education of the highest order in the Asia-Pacific region. Of the 16 applications, as told to me by Dr. Rojas, for the Doctor of Medicine program in the past 6 years, ending December 2014, only three were given approval to open and operate. And AUP College of Medicine was the very last of these three. Indeed, the CHED Technical Committee on Medical Education, chaired by my classmate in medical school, no less, made it truly difficult for new medical schools, including AUP, to open in the last decade, because they are asking this question: why open another medical school? As you have heard, we have 40-something already. So when we were, however, applying, there were still 38. At that time. So we, in the AUP community, especially the AUP and College of Medicine administrators, in the midst of the seemingly endless and insurmountable obstacles that we faced, were also tempted to ask the question, yes, indeed, whatever for? But we were not about to give up. Dr. Peter Landless, Global Health Director of the SDA Church. Where are you now, sir? Sir. In his Sabbath Divine Service message yesterday, has answered that question, why another medical school? As he clearly pointed out, that as this world of ours is rapidly nearing its final crisis in the end times of history, our thrust as God's people, you and me, is to rescue perishing souls. And we rescue not only the body, but the mind and the spirit. The AUP College of Medicine is such a school. It is committed, as our college motto states, to bring healing and wholeness through Christ, the great and the greatest of all physicians. Our school purposes to produce in each medical student who are preparing to be white-coated now, a physician molded and modeled after the greatest physician that ever walked this earth some 2,000 years ago. A physician who came to this world to rescue the perishing, and that, my beloved brothers and sisters, include you and me. As Dr. Lisa Beardsley Hardy, Global Director of Adventist Education, my very good friend and mentor, has time and again emphasized to all Adventist schools, it is important that we understand that the educational advantages offered by our schools are to be different from those offered by the schools of the world. Neither are we to follow the routine of worldly schools. Academically driven from childhood, I was blessed to have a Bible reading mother who constantly reminded me, what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and lose his soul? This biblical verse gave me focus. When I was a teacher at the West Visayas State University College of Medicine for 36 years and 3 months to be exact, before I joined AUP, my SDA students taught their teacher through their actions, not their words, what Jesus' teaching meant when he said, if you love me, keep my commandments, and which they did by honoring the Sabbath in addition to the rest of the nine. I cannot thank God enough for sending me those SDA students in my path to enlightenment. Constantly, I thank them in public, whether they hear it or not, but word gets to them. But more than that, I can only pay forward by accepting God's call through President Gayoba for the cause of Adventist medical education. That is the reason why I am now at AUP College of Medicine. Ellen G. White, God's end-time prophet, has said, the instruction given in Seventh-day Adventist schools is to be such as to lead. There is danger that our college will be turned away from its original design. God's purpose has been made known, that our people should have an opportunity to study the sciences, medical sciences, and at the same time to learn the requirements of His Word. Biblical lectures should be given. The study of the Scriptures should have the first place in our system of education. That is why, my beloved brethren, ladies and gentlemen, my faculty, the medical curriculum of this medical school is founded in the principle of integrating faith and learning. This means we offer the basic medical curriculum that every would-be physician should undergo. But over and above this, AUP-COM curriculum includes courses such as Med-R or Medicine, Humanity, and God for the healing not only of the body but also of the spirit. It has also incorporated in our preventive medicine course under Chair Tamano, the curriculum on lifestyle medicine based on biblical principles of health and wellness, which I would emphasize is evidence-based and proven by scientific studies. Now going to my teachers, who I'm so grateful have taken their busy time off to come and join us here. It is very important, therefore, that our college set before the world an example that will honor God. a work that God desires to be done through human agencies. Teachers who would bear the mark of divine academic excellence. It is therefore the privilege and challenge of every classroom teacher and every clinical preceptor of this college to reveal in all their work the leading of the Spirit of God. There is no education to be gained higher than that given to the early disciples, which we emulate. To gain the higher education means to follow God's word implicitly. It means to walk in the footsteps of Christ, practicing his virtue. A teacher cannot be a true educator until he or she be a learner in the school of Christ, receiving an education from the divine instructor himself. The kind of education produces results as lasting as eternity. Proverbs 9:10 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom." And this, ladies and gentlemen, parents of our beloved inaugural medical student, are the teachers who have been presented earlier to you by Dr. Narbarte and also asked to stand by Dr. Magnaye of BATMC. But of my 126 strong pioneer faculty, these highlighted people have chosen to come today. These are about 60 plus people, and I will not do them honor if I do not call them at least. Can you bear to listen to about 60 names? I just want you to see each one of them who are present. Dr. Ramon Alcira, please rise. Dr. Maria Lucia Alvarado. Pastor Lemuel Arit, our chaplain. Dr. Jali Balila, researcher. Dr. Mila Barzaga. Dr. Charmeline Bernardo. Dr. Arabel Berto. Dr. Demuel D. Berto, our college secretary. Dr. Janet Borgonia. Dr. Angelita Camacho. Dr. Ruby Tangonan. Dr. Lisel Canonigo. Dr. John Idalin Carbajal, our chair for the basic and preclinical. Dr. Eleanor Castillo. Dr. Danilo Cruz. Dr. Rene Cruz. Dr. Katrina Aquino Diaz. Dr. Miriam Estrada. Also the Dean of the College of Health, also a mother of one of the pioneer medical students. Dr. Carol Joy Felicen. Dr. Gerald Felicen. Dr. Odeline Flores. Dr. Chody Flores. Dr. Dina Galang. Dr. Gurley Garcia. Dr. Boots Garcia. Dr. Lendel Gachalian. Dr. President Francisco Gayoba. Our religion faculty. Dr. Joseph Guzlufan, Dr. Sharon Ibanez, Dr. and Pastor Rico Javien, religion teacher, Dr. J. La Madrid, Dr. Archie La Madrid, Dr. Efren Laksamana, Dr. Linda Lim Varona, our coordinator for the Adventist Medical Center Manila, Dr. Elsie Loxon, Dr. Ellen White Luna, Dr. Bibli Makaya, our Chair for Clinical Sciences and President of AMCM, Dr. Johan Manyes, who will teach us lifestyle medicine, Hannah Marquez, Doctor in Process, myself, Doris Mendoza, Nella Miado, Library Science, Dr. Elwin Montales, Dr. Attorney Leo Olarte, Dr. Joy Orbe, Dr. Alma Palarao, Dr. Joseph Palmero, Dr. Belen Rajagukguk, Dr. Irma Rajagukguk Magnaye, Dr. Jacqueline Salagubang, Dr. Rosario Salonga, Dr. Noruel Salvador, Dr. Sherwin Salvador, Dr. Ruth Santos Palomero, Dr. Kenneth Sibayan, Dr. Persida Soriano Cocos, Dr. Prudencio Santa Lucia, our newly appointed academic coordinator, Dr. Bienvenido Tamano, our chair for the Department of Family, Community, Preventive Medicine and Research, Dr. Grace Villamalayan, Dr. Maria Norma Zamora. These were part of the more original members. The newer ones who have just joined us from the August 18 evaluation of the Batangas, Dr. I will also call you. Dr. Maria Mercedes Araneta, Dr. Rafael Castillo, Dr. Isabel Paredes Cruz, Dr. Jesse Foronda Walde, Dr. Paulo Pagkatipunan, Dr. Reynaldo San Luis, okay, Dr. Orville Pandes, Dr. Aretha Singson Alday, Dr. Marion Rivera, yes, Dr. Leonardo Torres. Did I miss any names? Now from the Cherry, and Dr. Cherry Padua. For those who are coming from the Adventist Medical Center of Manila for the clinical clerkship mentoring, this is the one-on-one program where the pioneers medical students will rotate. May I present Dr. Rebecca Castillo, Dr. Marisa Cueto Velasco, Dr. Mirna Duldulao Milan, and for those coming from the Batangas Medical Center for our clinical exposure, all the way, Dr. Magnaye from first year, second year, third year, and clerkship. Of course, this is led by Dr. Ramoncito Magnaye, the chief himself, Dr. Nilo Alcoreza, Dr. Lalaine Picarburog, Dr. Merlita Publico, Dr. Celso Ramos, Dr. Angelita Villena, and I would also like to at this time mention somebody who offered her services. She's an SDA psychiatrist, Dr. Joy Banyares. But Agayares. So these are all the faculty, unless I missed to mention any names. Please speak up. So as I end this portion, I would like to declare in behalf of all my faculty and staff and students the words of our end time prophet. In reviewing our past, I can say, praise God. As I see what the Lord has wrought, I am filled with astonishment and with confidence in Christ as our Lord and Master. We have nothing to fear for the future, except as we shall forget the way the Lord has led us and His teaching in our lives. And before I leave, I would like to acknowledge our teacher based in the United States. He is going to be the one to liaison with the faculty from the States. I'm proud to present also a cardiologist by heart, a thoracic surgeon, Dr. Alfonso Miguel. Sir, so thank you very much for coming, everyone.
To introduce the pioneer class, let us welcome Dr. John Idalin Carbajal, the chair of the Basic and Preclinical Sciences of the College of Medicine.
To our distinguished leaders from the General Conference, our leaders from the Southern Asia Pacific Division, our SSD, to the administrators of the Adventist University of the Philippines, our local government officials and their representatives, PRC Ched included, to our very, very generous Awesnan Isnak fellow alumni who are around here, which I wish my father were part of right now, and to our national alumni, don't forget, hindi lang dollars ang nagpatayo nitong COM. Pesos also helped. Okay. To the fellow AUP faculty, staff, and employees who had several salary cuts just to help put up this building. To the parents who are sending these individuals up front to school, I would like to greet you a pleasant good afternoon, because it's already past 12 o'clock. I am very proud to present to you 17 of the 18 members of our Pioneer Class 2019. I say 2019 because they all aim to graduate in 2019. There are certain interesting facts about this first batch of students that we have. These are the students who will be bringing in bringing in what? Bringing in patients that are sick, not only physically, but otherwise, bringing in souls to the kingdom, because they will be going out, and they come from Korea, we have one foreign student, and various parts of the Philippines indicated by the red squares. For those that are from our specific region, we should take pride that we have Cavite, Laguna, and Batangas represented. We have the most from the NCR. We have someone from as far north as Isabela. We have two students from Mindanao. One is from Butuan City, and the other is from Bukidnon. Then we have someone from Sorsogon, and also someone from Romblon. So these 18 students comprise our batch. Note that there are 8 females, 10 males. Now, why only 17? We have one student who was not able to get a booking to be here in time. His flight arrives tomorrow from the States. He's a Filipino, but he had to be there for important reasons, so he's missing out on this ceremony today. Okay. Mr. John Sergey Jimenez Aklan. Hold it. He's the leader of the pack. May I now call on the members of the white coat ceremony? Why do I say he's the leader? Even before he enrolled, he was asking me about student organizations, medical student council, and so many other things. And fortunately, when it comes to alphabetizing them, he falls number one. So I'm teasing him to be the leader alphabetically. Okay, John Sergey Jimenez Aklan is a certified Batanggenyo from Lipa, grandson of someone you well know, our Dr. Jimenez. He finished his BS Physical Therapy at the University of the Philippines just this year. And he is a very, very well-known violinist. So with him around, you can be assured doctors at the COM are going to be making music. Jesly Rose Acoba from Isabela. She's a graduate of our Manila Adventist College at the Sanitarium, finished her BS Nursing in 2014 as magna cum laude and president of her class. Joy Bellarmino is the first of our Caviteñas. She hails from Silang, finished her Bachelor in Medical Laboratory Science in 2013 here at our own AUP. She has been working at a government institution since then. And the individual who would not be around is Alain Justin Sikam Burbano. He is a graduate of this AUP, although it's his second course, because he initially was in engineering at UP. When he got to the States, he realized that engineers were losing their jobs, so he decided to come back and take up a medical course instead. Then we have Alexan De La Cruz Bernardino. He hails from Pasay City. He finished his medical technology course here, BSML, as a magna cum laude student in 2014. Janina Bianca Garce Cabile, likewise, is another clinical laboratory scientist here from our own school. Class 2013, she hails from Sorsogon. I ask her, what do we call people from Sorsogon? Do you know? They are called Sorsoganons. She got the honors of cum laude. Christopher Dale Gayemit Chua. He is outstanding because of his size, and he hails from the De La Salle University, Manila. He finished his BS Physics Pre-Med just this 2015. He is from Laguna. Lexan Erdin Lim Cordial. Though her parents are from different provinces, she just calls herself a Caviteña because she grew up in AUP since primary through secondary through college, and here she is at our medical school. This special lady finished her BS nursing in 2011. She has done masteral studies already. She has gone into teaching, and she was honored with the Magna Cum Laude in batch 2019. Paul Rothwell Condino de Jesus, another Lagunense, graduate also of our own AUP in 2010. He too has been working, teaching, and waiting for our medical school to open. So right now, here we have him with us. Vanda Charisse Costillas de Holde. This lady comes from Butuan City, down south. She finished her BS Biology this year at the Father Urio Saturnino University. Something interesting about this lady and Mr. Chua earlier was the morning they were here for their interview, their fathers were looking at each other suspiciously. Then one was brought brave enough to ask a few details. You know what they discovered? The lady from Butuan and the guy from Laguna, their fathers are cousins who had last seen each other in the 1980s. And here they met, and their children are going to be classmates. Wimerson Razon Estrada, another kid who considers himself a full-blooded Caviteño who grew up in AUP. He finished his BS nursing in 2014 with the honor of cum laude. He also was the president of his class. April Ray Obregon Garces, AUP graduate of BS Biology in 2014. Of this pioneer class, she's the only one who holds the distinction of having earned a summa cum laude. She hails from Pasay City. Se Yun Jang. She's our sole Korean, but for some reasons, she had to leave earlier. She was with the processional. Anyway, Se Yun Jang finished a number of degrees. She finished her BA in communication at the Andrews University. She took her Master's of Arts in Education Counseling at La Sierra University. She did some pre-med studies at Weimar, then went home to Korea and finished at our Adventist university called Samyuk University in 2013. Imar Lloyd Pagonzaga Mansagiton. He comes all the way from Bukidnon, an MVC graduate of BS Nursing in 2014, magna cum laude. Adrian Clifford Rodriguez, another BMLS graduate of AUP in the year 2010. He is a Cavinteño by heart, went to school at our own Binyan SDA school and other Adventist schools. This is the guy who is the easiest to smile and to laugh in the batch. Andy Graham Molino Rosas from CPAC, Central Philippines Adventist College, finished his nursing there in 2010, worked abroad as an OFW for a while to save money for school. Now he's back and he hails from Romblon. He promises to go back to Romblon to work. Neem Franjo II Agagas Salazar. He had all his schooling again here at AUP, so he considers himself a first generation Cavitenyo. Finished his BMLS in 2014 here at AUP as a Dean's Lister. Julian Rowley Aujero Sanchez. She hails from Caloocan. She finished her BSN with the honor of clinical excellence and magna cum laude. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's give this first batch, our inaugural batch, a big round of applause.
To lead out in the Christian Physician Oath, let us welcome Dr. Linda Varona.
May I request our faculty members to please stand as a witness to this physician's oath. May I request our medical students to please raise your right hand and follow after me. The physician's oath. Before God, these things I do promise. In the acceptance of my sacred calling, I will dedicate my life to the furtherance of Jesus Christ's healing and teaching ministry. I will give to my teachers the respect and gratitude which is their due. I will impart to those who follow me the knowledge and experience that I have gained. The wholeness of my patient will be my first consideration. Acting as a good steward of the resources of society and of the talents granted me, I will endeavor to reflect God's mercy and compassion by caring for the lonely, the poor, the suffering, and those who are dying. I will maintain the utmost respect for human life. I will not use my medical knowledge contrary to the laws of humanity. I will respect the rights and decisions of my patients. I will hold in confidence all secrets committed to my keeping in the practice of my calling. I will lead my life and practice my art. with purity and honor, abstaining from immorality myself. I will not lead others into moral wrongdoing. May God's kingdom, His healing power and glory be experienced by those whom I serve. And may they be made known in my life in proportion as I am faithful to this oath. Congratulations. May God bless you and welcome to the AUP College of Medicine family.
Before we are going to have our litany of praise and dedication, and afterwards the dedicatory prayer for our inaugural class and then the closing prayer, I would like to announce, because after the closing song, okay, there's a song that will be sung by the AUP ambassadors for each one of us, and especially for the inner choir class. After the prayer, we'll ask you to go out from this side for our ribbon cutting. And these are the individuals, institutions that will be part of the ribbon cutting. We have from the health department of the General Conference. Then we have the education department. We have the chair of the board of AUP from the North Philippines, and the president of AUP, Dr. Gayuba, the dean of the College of Medicine, Dr. Doris Mendoza, and training hospital, Dr. Magnaye, and from the CHED, Dr. Yanga, and from Singapore, we have Lei Kai Beng. And from our alumni associations, from ISNAC, Dr. Kines, and AWESNA, Dr. Elmer Bangloy. For our litany of praise and dedication, I would like to invite you to open your program on page 20, and we'll have this litany of praise and dedication. I will read the leader part, and you will read the congregation part. And I would like to ask you to please stand for our litany of praise and dedication. From all corners of the earth, we have come together this momentous day to give thanks to you, O Lord, to sing praises to your name, for you have made us glad by your work, and at the works of your hands we sing for joy. After many years of waiting and praying, we have come together today to celebrate your faithfulness to your people. O God, you have prospered the works of our hands, and you have enabled us by your grace and power to complete this alumni hall and College of Medicine building for the glory of your name. Today we stand together to dedicate this building to you, to the glory of God our Father, from whom comes every good and perfect gift, to the honor of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, Redeemer and King, to the praise of the Holy Spirit, our Comforter, Teacher, and Guide.